But the imagery is Christian, Chuck.
No, Harry, it's what it is. It's just itself. It's just magic. Magic. Look. Let me show you. The child steps into the water. The coats are thick and heavy. The child must push through. They're pressing close, almost suffocating. And suddenly there's white light, crisp cold air, trees, snow. Total contrast, you see. It's the gateway to a magical world.
C.S. Lewis was an Anglican rather than a Roman Catholic,
and that is probably the first and most obvious objection to my finding Catholic themes in the Narnia stories, or even my calling them Catholic books. But there are a couple points I would like to bring up in response to this. One is that Lewis himself delighted that readers were finding layers of symbolism in the Narnia books that he himself hadn't intended. Indeed, in his unfinished essay on criticism, he writes, "It is the author who intends. The book means." Of a book's meaning, in this sense, its author is not necessarily the best and is never a perfect judge. One of his intentions usually was that it should have a certain meaning. He cannot be sure that it has. He cannot even be sure that the meaning he intended it to have was in every way, or even at all, better than the meaning which readers find in it. Here, therefore, the critic has great freedom to range without fear of contradiction from the author's superior knowledge. So I feel justified in saying that I have his blessing in seeing Catholic meanings in the Narnia books, even if they weren't fully intended by the author. Secondly, Lewis's mind was drenched in the writings and the theology of the patristic and the medieval eras. Therefore, Catholic artists and theologians would have held a strong influence over both his reasoning and his imagination. And it shouldn't surprise us that their effects would surface in his fiction, particularly since many themes that would resonate with Catholics would have no real objectionality to an Anglican who professed the Book of Common Prayer as the expression of his faith. With justification secured, let's look at the most popular of the Narnia books and the one that really ought to be read first, The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. This tale is familiar to most of us, and in some ways conforms comfortably to the pattern that Joseph Campbell famously laid out for the monomyth. Average people are drawn to an adventure which changes and ultimately matures them, and they return home at the end of the story different and better people. Tolkien obviously used that framework to great effect, and Lewis does so here with the Pevensey children. In fact, a lot of the content of the Chronicles of Narnia makes a lot of sense if you consider them accounts of Aslan's rites of passage for the children that he calls to Narnia. Here, this occurs when the Pevensey children discover another world hidden inside a wardrobe. This is an important point. In the novel, the wardrobe door isn't a portal or a stargate to some other dimension if you use it the right way. No, for Lewis, Narnia sometimes exists inside the wardrobe, and the children have no control when it will be there or when it won't. It's only when Aslan wills it to be there that it is there. The idea that magic is just technology is a familiar one. Clark's third law states that any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic. And Aleister Crowley defined magic as the science and art of causing change to occur in conformity with will. As Lewis writes, "There is something which unites magic and applied science, or technology, while separating both from the wisdom of earlier ages. For the wise men of old, the cardinal problem had been how to conform the soul to reality, and the solution had been knowledge, self-discipline, and virtue. For magic and applied science alike, the problem is how to subdue reality to the wishes of men. The solution is a technique. And both, in the practice of this technique, are ready to do things hitherto regarded as disgusting and impious, such as digging up and mutilating the dead." This is why it almost feels wrong to group both the sorcerer's power to bend things to his will with a spell and the wonders of Narnia under the word magic.
Why have you got a phone box in your room?
It's not a phone box, it's my wardrobe. I've just painted it to look like a phone box.
The TARDIS is magic in the sense of being technology, but the wardrobe is not. The children in the book can't make access to Narnia subject to their will. It is all subject to Aslan's will. This is an important point for understanding the sacraments of the Catholic Church. Protestants have often accused Catholics of believing in magic because they believe that physical items can confer grace or change simply as the result of a priest saying certain words over them. Indeed,
Many think that the expression hocus pocus is a parody of the Latin words of institution said at Mass when transubstantiation occurs. Hoc est corpus meum. This is my body. Yet Catholics don't believe that the priest causes the bread and wine to change form in some kind of mechanistic or automatic way when he speaks the words of institution, or that the bread and the wine have some kind of inherent properties that he is manipulating it in order to get the desired effect. No, transubstantiation happens only because God gratuitously chooses to bind himself to his promise to make grace available to us under certain circumstances that proclaim his death and resurrection. In this sense, as Pope Francis recently put it, the sacraments are not magical rites. On the other hand, there is a certain magic to them in the sense that Chesterton defines magic in a chapter of his book Orthodoxy titled The Ethics of Elfland, in the sense that everything in creation is magical, because it was all the result of words that were uttered in accordance with will, but in this case, the magician is God himself. Narnia is magical because Narnia is sacramental. And a big clue to the sacramentality of Narnia is in the very fact that it is inside the house of Professor Diggory Kirk.
Would, of course. Not
before you. And again, it is inside the house. This is an important point established in the story.
But these things aren't ours.
No, but it is cold. And it isn't as though we're taking them out of the house. We shan't even be taking them out of the wardrobe.
I suppose that this whole country's in the wardrobe.
In the book, you describe the house as belonging to an old professor who has no wife, and yet, you say that when the little girl enters the magic wardrobe, she finds it full of fur coats!
Oh, very good, Eddie.
It's simple. They belong to the professor's old mother. Simple.
The house is somewhat magical and enchanted itself, and it is surely no coincidence that the housekeeper is named Mrs. McCready, or Mrs. Macready. The house makes them ready for Narnia. And remember that the name Kirk comes from the Old English word for church. It's still used this way in Scotland. So this Old English house is the house of church. Lewis makes this connection when he mentions that some of the books in the house were bigger than the Bibles at church. So all of this is taking place in a church context, in an ecclesial context, and the house itself is making them ready for Narnia, just as Narnia in some sense is making them ready for the church. And if Narnia appears inside a church, we should expect it to have a sacramental element. Not only that, but also a liturgical element. And this is precisely what we find. There is certainly a little liturgical touches to Narnia, such as when Mr. Beaver bows at the mention of the name of Adam. This reminds us of the rule of the general instruction of the Roman Missal. A bow of the head is to be made at Mass when the three divine persons are named together, and at the names of Jesus, or of the Blessed Virgin Mary, and of the saint in whose honor Mass is being celebrated. But larger than that is the way that the book encapsulates the two great celebrations of the Church's liturgical calendar, Christmas and Easter. The situation of Narnia at the beginning of the book is that the usurping White Witch has cast a spell which causes it to be always winter in Narnia, but never to be Christmas. Now in our world, just as winter is getting bitter and the whole earth seems frozen, dead, and hopeless, the Church begins its liturgical year with the period known as Advent, a preparation for Christmas, which runs through most of December. It is meant to be a time of repentance and preparing our hearts for the coming of Christ, making our hearts ready, if you will. And Christmas itself occurs around the time of the winter solstice, just at the time when the days slowly begin to get longer, when light breaks into the world, and winter slowly begins to end, and the world slowly begins to be reborn. There is a logic to all of this. The Feast of the Annunciation, or the Conception of Jesus, is celebrated on March 25th, exactly 9 months before Christmas. In between these, we have the celebration of the birth of St. John the Baptist on June 24th. Now, this was once thought to be the summer solstice, when the days begin to grow shorter, whereas Christmas marks the days beginning to grow longer, in fulfillment of the Baptist's prophecy that he must increase and I must decrease. All of this can be found in Benedict XVI's essential book, The Spirit of the Liturgy. Tolkien fans should note that the Fellowship of the Ring embarks on their journey on December 25th, and the Ring of Power is destroyed on March 25th, which marks the beginning of the New Year, just as the Feast of the Annunciation was at one point New Year's Day in England. But what does that have to do with Narnia? Well, there are two major Advent figures in the novel. One of them is Father Christmas, who, of course, is a mythologized version of the Catholic Saint Nicholas, whose feast day falls on December 6th, squarely within Advent. Just as Father Christmas's arrival in Narnia heralds the coming of Christmas and of Aslan, Saint Nicholas's appearance in the liturgy marks the coming of Jesus to this world at Christmas. Notice, by the way, that Father Christmas gives Susan a horn that can summon help. In Tolkien's Father Christmas letter, St. Nicholas also possesses such a horn, and he blows it when his house is attacked by goblins. This lends credence to my theory that they are the same Father Christmas, and that the Pevensey children exist in the same continuity as Middle-earth, but that's neither here nor there. More notably still is the fact that on what was once thought to be the winter solstice, the darkest day of the year, December 13th, the church commemorates St. Lucy. The saint whose very name comes from the Latin word lux, for light, and who is often depicted carrying eyes on a platter. She symbolizes illumination and guidance, as well as innocence, for she was a virgin martyr. In the Scandinavian country, St. Lucy's Day is marked by processions, where girls will wear white and carry candles. In this way, the church fights the darkness of winter with its own patron saint of light. And thus, it should not surprise us that the girl who first gets into Narnia, and who is gifted with the greatest insight, the one who guides the others, and who gets to notice things first, is named Lucy. She is herself an Advent symbol. This is, by the way, why I disapprove of both the BBC and the Walden Media movie depicting Lucy as a brunette. The fact that she is blonde is not an accident. Her appearance should evoke light just as much as her name does. And it is equally no coincidence that Easter is celebrated in the spring, at the time when the world itself seems to be coming to life and proclaiming the joy of the resurrection. Indeed, the name of the penitential period leading up to Easter, Lent, is simply an Old English word for spring. So it's no coincidence that a whole chapter is dedicated to describing Narnia turning into spring, and this is the season in which Aslan dies and rises again. Of course, all this happens a lot more quickly in the book than in the church's calendar, where Christmas and Easter are several months apart, but then again, time passes faster in Narnia than it does here. Now, the Chronicles of Narnia are not intended to be allegorical, despite the common misperception, but they do clearly contain parallels and commentaries. In forbidding Christmas from coming to Narnia, the White Witch may be seen as analogous to the Puritans, who banned the celebration of Christmas in England and America, both for being too Catholic and for promoting a revelry which was quite incompatible with the Puritan ethic of restraint. A puritanical streak can certainly be seen in the White Witch, especially in the scene when she happens upon a Christmas party, which Lewis describes using the word Mary.
What is the meaning of all this gluttony? Waste! This self-indulgence!
The Catholic Neo-Thomist philosopher Father Joseph Pieper, in his book on the virtues, suggests that the Antichrist may be a champion of a sort of temperance which is itself untempered by the virtue of justice, and this sounds a lot like an apt description of the White Witch. The celebration of Christmas was thus practically unknown in England until Charles Dickens wrote A Christmas Carol. G.K. Chesterton praised the book for being a vindication of a Catholic holiday, and indeed slyly suggested that Scrooge had converted from being a Puritan to being a Catholic. C.S. Lewis, though, thought that the book promoted a version of Christmas which was basically defanged of any of its specific Christian reference. There's no discussion of the Incarnation, for example, in the book. The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe can be seen as Lewis redressing the balance of his improvement on A Christmas Carol, where Christmas is not only restored to England, but is restored in its full Christian glory. And in this sense, I think it is fair to call The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe a very Catholic book. Thus we see that Narnia is sacramental and liturgical, and no wonder, for it all takes place in the house of church. But in what ways does the house make them ready for Narnia? Well, at one point, the children express excitement at the possibility of discovering animals.
I wonder what other things we'll find here.
Hawks.
Eagles.
Badgers.
I'd love to see a badger.
I wonder if there are stags.
And they are disappointed when rain prevents them from doing so, and instead compels them to stay in the house, prompting the discovery of Narnia. Weather providentially drives the plot in several times in the story. Of course, they will discover animals in Narnia, and not only will they find a multitude of different creatures, they will in some ways discover their meanings. Lewis is very deliberate about which creatures he uses, and for which purposes, in Narnia, and what personalities he assigns to them. There is always a logic to it, and a lot of that logic is probably drawn from the early Christian work, the Physiologos, which contains several legends about several different animals, and always finds a kind of theological significance in them. The Christian imagination has always treated the natural world as an illustration of gospel truths, and Narnia is firmly within that tradition. So, for example, when we first encounter Aslan, there are several animals mentioned as traveling in his camp, including a unicorn and a pelican. The Physiologos, taking its cue from the legend that a unicorn can only be caught by a virgin, sees in it a symbol for Christ, who can only be found by the pure. The pelican is even more interesting. It was commonly thought that the pelican resurrected her young by pecking a wound in her side and pouring her blood out to nourish the offspring back to life. This became a common symbol for Christ's crucifixion and the way he feeds us with his shed blood in the Eucharist. Durham Cathedral had the sacrament reserved in a tabernacle shaped like a pelican. The pelican's presence here foreshadows Aslan's own destiny. In contrast, among the creatures present at Aslan's murder is an ape, which the Physiologos sees as a symbol of Satan. Going back to a remark by Tertullian, the medieval church often described the devil as God's ape, grotesquely mimicking and parodying his attributes and his activities. The White Witch is in many ways an excellent illustration of this. She is a parody of Father Christmas, traveling in her own sledge and with her own reindeer, although they are white and smaller than Father Christmas's, and are described using hellish imagery. Their horns glint like fire, and the steam from their nostrils is like smoke. Her dwarf slaves are even a parody of Santa's elves.
Sit by me on my sledge, and I will wrap a mantle around you.
In wrapping her mantle around Edmund, she is also a parody of the traditional iconography of Our Lady of Mercy, who is depicted as wrapping children in her own mantle. Indeed, a lot of the White Witch makes a lot more sense if you would interpret her as a satanic parody of Our Blessed Mother. She is the new Lilith, while Mary is the new Eve. And moreover, despite her screechings against gluttony, she subverts Edmund by thwarting his reason using his passions. The Catholic anthropology from St. Augustine down through St. Thomas Aquinas has always understood that while we have a physical, corporeal component and animal passions, we also have a reason, which Donne called God's viceroy, to govern our passions like a monarch and to rightly order and restrain them. At the fall of man, our reason was usurped, and now our passions often conquer our better judgment. This is called concupiscence. Training in the virtues is meant to restore reason to its proper place over the passions, which is why prudence is called the charioteer of the virtues in the Catholic Catechism. It is reason which gives us our moral sense, our conscience, and the seat of the image of God in men. To act irrationally, or to sin, is to damage the image of God and become more bestial. Thus, the talking animals in Narnia have moral obligations because they have moral reasoning. This is why good creatures in Narnia often have the body of an animal but the head of a human being, like a centaur. The opposite is usually evil. Thus, in Aslan's camp is a bull with the head of a man, while in the White Witch's camp is a man with the head of a bull. Rationality is goodness. This, by the way, is why I dislike how the Narnia movies have good Minotaur characters, like Tavros in Voyage of the Dawn Treader. Doesn't seem true to the message of the Narnia books. With Edmund, his natural caution and skepticism is overthrown when the White Witch gives him magic Turkish delight, which is enchanted so that it can never satisfy him, but always makes him want to eat more. There is a theory whereby each of the Chronicles exhibits one of the seven deadly sins, and the line the Witch in the Wardrobes would seem to be gluttony. Edmund becomes dim-witted and animalistic in his desire for more candy, and this is what drives his betrayal. It is interesting that Lewis describes the towers on the witch's house as resembling giant dunce caps. Sin makes you stupid. Note that the copper vial which produces the Turkish delight is a parody of Lucy's diamond vial, which heals injuries, and it's all made in an inferior metal. It may also be a parody of Mrs. Beaver's vial, which is used to put the children to sleep.
Ah! I've just the thing!
And even her false promise to make Edmund a prince is a parody of his own true destiny to one day be a king. Just as Satan tempted Eve with the prospect of becoming godlike, even though participation in the divine nature was already her destiny, which she forfeited by trusting the serpent. It's worth noting that Edmund is also the name of a famous English saint king. Going back to Professor Kirk's house, we see another way in which the children are made ready for Narnia. Right before all four children get into Narnia, Peter and Edmund are examining a suit of armor and wondering if it can be taken apart. What Lion, Witch, and the Wardrobe does is take this concept of chivalry and, so to speak, takes it apart, that is to say, demonstrates its constitutive parts, shows what it means to be chivalrous. In Mere Christianity, when C.S. Lewis is explaining why he doesn't believe that Christianity is a pacifist religion, he cites the Christian ideal of the knight, and in some ways the boys both learn what it means to be a knight. Peter through his experience of killing the wolf despite being afraid of it, and Edmund through using his cunning to knock the wand out of the witch's hand in the Battle of Verona. Lewis specifically mentions that if Maugrim hadn't been so angry that he stopped to roar, Peter would have had no chance against him. again proving the importance of reason controlling the passions. The ideal of the Christian knight was defined by St. Bernard of Clairvaux when he wrote the rule for the order of the Knights Templar, based on the rules he had already devised for his own Cistercian order. The knight was a kind of warrior monk in St. Bernard's understanding, and of course today a Catholic lay organization is called the Knights of Columbus, trying to promote Christian virtue among men. These ideals are consistently upheld within the Chronicles of Narnia. Note that Peter and Edmund both have to display the virtues of fortitude, or as Lewis put it in Mere Christianity, of guts, and of prudence when they go into battle. Peter's own role in the story is fascinating. As the eldest, when the children are made kings and queens of Narnia, Peter is not simply the first among equals. He is the High King over all the others. It's hard not to see an analogy between this and the Petrine office of the papacy, which is higher than the other bishoprics, as the Catholic Catechism explains. Just as by the Lord's institution, St. Peter and the rest of the apostles constitute a single apostolic college, so in like fashion the Roman pontiff, Peter's successor, and the bishops, the successors of the apostles, are related with and united to one another. But the Lord made Simon alone, whom he named Peter, the rock of his church. He gave him the keys of his church and instituted him shepherd of the whole flock. The college or body of bishops has no authority unless united with the Roman pontiff, Peter's successor, as its head. It is worth noting that he is knighted when he, as Aslan's second-in-command, kills Maugrim, the witch's second-in-command. The wolf could represent at least two things. If the White Witch is primarily understood as a picture of Lucifer, Maugrim could represent pagan Rome, driven by satanic principles, which was famously represented by the wolf nursing Romulus and Remus. Peter killing the wolf could represent how the papacy-led church had succeeded the Roman Empire, which collapsed and was punishment for its manifold wickedness, as described by St. Augustine in his City of God. Also, in the American edition of The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, Lewis changed the name of the wolf from Maugrim to Fenris Ulf, the name of a wolf from Norse mythology. The wolf could then represent the fierce pre-Christian winter mythology of the Germanic tribes, which was conquered by the church. Peter slaying the wolf by a tree reminds us of how St. Boniface chopped down the yoke of Jupiter and used the wood to build a church, the Church of St. Peter, in fact. This is Peter's arc, but what about Edmund's? Another theory has it that each of the Narnia Chronicles uphold one of the seven sacraments. In this account, it would be tempting to assume that since the major vice is gluttony, the sacrament would be the Eucharist. And indeed, there are a couple of Last Supper images in the novel. The Meal of the Beavers, where prophecy is explained and the traitor leaves the meal early. And the Quiet Supper on the night of Aslan's murder. But in fact, the major sacrament of the book is confession, reconciliation, as seen in Aslan's conversation with Edmund. It's a private conversation which no one can hear, which reminds us of the seal of the confessional, and it changes Edmund forever. It should also be noted that the way Aslan's atonement is depicted isn't very Protestant. It certainly doesn't sound like a penal substitution. Some have seen it as closer to the patristic ransom theory of the atonement, called the Christus Victor theory by Gustav Allen. Lewis's biographer, the theologian Alistair McGrath, suggests that Lewis wasn't so much basing Aslan's atonement on any particular theological theory, but more on the medieval mystery plays. By the way, as in the Gospels, only women witness the resurrection, and the name Susan may be a reference to Susanna of the myrrh-bearing women, or it may just be because Sue rhymes with Lou. In the same way, Aslan rescuing the captives from the witch's house is clearly based on the harrowing of hell, which rarely shows up in Protestant theology, but was a regular fixture of medieval art, legend, and iconography, as well as being a fixture of Catholic dogma. Finally, when Professor Kirk is told Lucy's story about the country and the wardrobe, he uses logic to demonstrate that she is probably telling the truth. This scene is obviously illustrating Lewis's famous liar, lunatic, or lord trilemma argument for Christianity. But he also remarks that nothing is more probable than that there is a multitude of worlds.
You mean there really could be other worlds all over the place?
Well, nothing is more probable. Oh, I wonder what they do teach them at these schools.
Now, Professor Kirk knows that there are many worlds because he's been to the wood between the worlds, but what makes him think that logic dictates that it's most probable that there are many worlds? Well, perhaps he read Origin of Alexandria, who wrote, "A diversity of worlds may exist with changes of no unimportant kind, so that the state of another world may be for some unmistakable reasons better than this, and for others worse, and for others again intermediate. But what may be the number or measure of this, I confess myself ignorant. Although, if any can tell it, I would gladly learn." Now, that after this age, which is said to be formed for the consummation of other ages, there will be other ages to follow, we have clearly learned from Paul himself, who says that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness towards us. He has not said in the age to come, nor in the two ages to come, whence I infer that by his language many ages are indicated. Now, if there is something greater than ages, so that among created beings certain ages may be understood, but among other beings which exceed and surpass visible creatures, ages still greater, which perhaps will be the case at the restitution of all things, when the whole universe will come to a perfect termination, perhaps that period in which the consummation of all things will take place is to be understood as something more than an age. In other words, perhaps there is another world, where Christ will be glorified, where what happened on Earth will redound throughout the universe, and it'll all come together at the culmination of the ages, or of the worlds, depending on how you translate that. Perhaps Professor Kirk has read Origin of Alexandria. Perhaps he likes the idea that there are many worlds where Christ can be glorified. There's nothing really more Catholic or more universal than that. C.S. Lewis intended The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe not to be an allegory, not to teach anything, but to be a good story. And it is a great story. But I do think that as Catholics we can read it very profitably, and not just be entertained, but find really deep, almost confirmations of things that we always intuited and always perceived. We can hear echoes of our own saints and our own wisdom. And I think it's very profitable to notice these themes, so that we leave a story like this not only entertained, but edified. Not simply because we recognize certain elements that look like something from Catholicism, because those very elements point us back to Christ. And I can't imagine that Lewis would have minded that. Take care.